Good evening, good evening to one and all. It's a beautiful Wednesday evening, and we are broadcasting this internet live stream program from way up high in the mountain where the air is cooler. Guess where we are? We've been here before. We are in the South Reward District at the mansion of the Richardson, David Richardson Sr, David Richardson Jr, the family Richardson, and we want to welcome you to another live stream interact program. We want to just say hi right now to our other host, Jeff Richardson, before we get into our guest, and I want Jeffrey to just talk to you for a minute or two, because we need to say hi to those of you who are, you know, live streaming from all around the world, and we also want to give our condolences to a few families that have been losing some loved ones in the past few weeks. So Jeffrey, I'm going to give you the opportunity to get into that right before we welcome our special guest for this evening, Wednesday's Interact program.
Yes, Roberto, you just mentioned the fact that there are some of our friends that has passed on, and one of them I want to mention is our neighbor that is very close to us, which is Miss Blondell Warner, who has passed on, and her funeral will be on Tuesday coming, on the 8th. It was a shock to every one of us, and we pray that her family, you know, would be able to keep strong in the Lord, and that they will continue to, you know, not to allow this to, you know, get to them, but to be able to think about the memories they had with Blondell when she was alive. You know, and I also want to say, extend condolences to my good friend, Calvin Manborough. His mother also passed, and I want to extend condolences to him as well. And also to his family, his son also, by the name of Calvin as well. And he has a brother, I think, plays the bass. I can't remember his name, a very close friend of ours. I want to say, extend sincere condolences to them as well. And today is going to be a special program, like Roberto said.
Before you said it, while you're giving condolences, we also need to mention the passing of the son of Elaine Rowland. I cannot remember his name.
We know him very well.
Yes. Give condolences to his mom and to his
Ilian's son.
Ilian's son to
Charles.
And Charles and all of them.
Yeah, Renee.
Renee passed away just a few days ago. So we want to send out condolences to him, to them as well. And then Jeffrey, take us right around the world.
Yeah, well, we're accustomed to going straight around the world, from in Africa to Europe to the United States of America to the Caribbean islands. I don't want to single them out. We are accustomed to singling out all of those countries, and I want to say to all of them, I hope that they will be able to share this program with them, because it's going to be an exciting program this evening. And the person that is going to be our guest this evening is a very, very important person, a very, very intelligent person. And he's going to be giving you information pertaining to the area of South Reward. So I want to say to you, Roberto, I'm going to pass the floor back over to you, who will be the one that's going to present our guest for this evening.
Thank you very much, Jeffrey. As we said and I mentioned earlier, we want to say thank you, and we are very grateful again to the Richardson family here in South Reward. And we cannot forget to mention, the head of this home, David Richardson Sr. And we can also mention right away then that our guest is David Richardson Jr., his son, who has been on this program many times with us. But Mrs. Richardson, we want to say hi to her as well. She's off Ireland, and we want to bring much greetings to her, I guess. David Jr., he will have to say where she's at, you know, but it's not important because that's a private matter. But we want to just thank the family again. But we want to get it right into the program for this evening. For a matter of fact, David is going to really delve into, you know, introduction as to the topic at hand and what he wants to discuss, and then we're just going to just flow with him. So without any further ado, again, we want to say welcome to you, David. It is always a pleasure to have you on the program with us, man. You know, it's like bro, how we hang, you know? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
You know, so it's always an exciting when we get on the program because there's so many exciting things that you talk about. But today, you know, we did not even plan this for weeks. We did not even know that we were going to have this program with you. Normally, Jeffrey and I do our home alone.
Correct.
But something just came up, and then you just needed to step in and have this program with us. Correct. So we are allowing you, we are having you lead the program, because there's a few matters in South Taiwan that you want to touch on.
Correct.
We want to give you all the space and all the time to talk about that. So thank you very much again for coming on Interact Live Stream. We want you to just go right into the topic that you really want to discuss with the people of St. Maarten, all of the other live stream viewers all around the world.
Yes. Okay, so good evening, gentlemen. Good evening, Roberto. Good evening, Jeffrey. Good evening, livestream viewers from around the world. Once again, just to reintroduce myself, my name is David Richardson. I am the resident of South Taiwan. I'm also the president of the St. Maarten Community Collective of South Taiwan. So that's the official title. For those of you, the collective is a council. It's a community-based organization with different chapters, right? With South Taiwan, of course, with Ebenezer, Raymond Dutch Quarter. And it was basically structured to be an association, okay? So that's where the members have all the say, the members vote, the members would be the residents. So the members that would be applicable would be the residents of South Taiwan, and then they would vote the executive board, let me say, the association members then in. Today I'm here with a heavy heart. You know, we normally just have fun on this program, but today is a little more serious. We had an issue in South Taiwan yesterday, and I think one thing with South Taiwan residents, they hold you accountable. They keep fire under your foot. Okay, so there was an incident. I would just like to just touch base also and just introduce my members also, because it's not just about me. It's really a collective. And that's what we are, a collective, where each member, residents, and each member of the association have a say. So once again, I'm the president of the St. Maarten's Community Collective of South Taiwan. I have the treasurer, which is Mr. Pedro Granger. I have the secretary, which is Hendrika Martina. And I have the two board members, which is Isha Marlin and Mr. Sergio York. They also call him Baby, okay? Just a brief synopsis of the establishment of the collective, because it was spearheaded by Ms. Zaira Hillman, and it was established in 2015, okay? Basically, like I said, it's just community-based. What they did was sign the MOU with the MPC school for the use of the outdoor basketball court to facilitate certain initiatives. Some of the initiatives they wanted to do was basically Zumba and outdoor activities for the elderly, kids' summer programs, movie nights, you know, that type of stuff, just community activities, initiatives to kind of bring the community together and, you know, just to have some kind of activeness in the community, you know. One of the main things that I think the residents of South Taiwan always expect is the lighting of the they call it the Christmas tree, right? It's not a Christmas tree. The official name is the reward tree. That's the official name for it. It's a reward tree. What we do we use it as a Christmas tree because during the December month, you know, when everybody's festivities and, you know, the Christmas month, as they would call it, we would put lights around the tree. We would have, you know, we would have refreshments for the residents. We would have gifts for the kids. And, you know, we would just have, you know, just come and celebrate, you know, celebrate life, celebrate each other, you know. As you mentioned earlier, there's a lot of death that been happening. You know, we lost a lot of people in our lives, a lot of people that's near and dear to us. And, you know, it's always good to have these kind of things to be able to, you know, remember, you know, that we have to appreciate life. You know, remember that God gave us another day, and He gives us a day to be able to, you know, to execute and do what we have to do and make use of the purpose of life. You understand? Have a legacy behind, leave something back for our kids. These are the type of things that we focus on, right? So there was an incident. I'm going to jump right into it. I had a few points. Yes, go ahead.
I want to jump in because before you go to the incident, yes. Yes, that's where you've got to really highlight.
Yes, correct.
I wanted to really, because you and I spoke a bit earlier, and a few times before, about the purpose and the, you know, you talked about a few of the activities of the connectivity.
Correct.
I want you to
touch base on
any other purposes, like, you know, community upkeep of Salty Ward and the other neighboring districts, you know, things that, you know, pertain to not just activities, but let's say the infrastructure and the stuff like that. Is that also included in what you do?
Absolutely. So, okay, so like I said, just to delve in a little bit of the MOU. The MOU for the that was signed with MPC was to use the facilities there, so the outdoor basketball court and certain classrooms in the school. Now, that would be to hold our community collective meetings. That would also be to have to schedule and manage the use by members. Members, when I say members, the residents of the community, to be able to upkeep the facilities as well. We signed the MOU to be able to, the bathrooms if we use them, you know, the area around the outdoor basketball court. We are responsible to have that looking, you know, up to par, so to speak. Okay? Now, the thing is, the previous board, like I said, Ms. Zaira Hillemon, she basically wrote to government and had countless meetings with certain NGOs, SMDF, that was one of them, the AUC school was another one. What they wanted to do was basically build a... because that's what we're going to in hurricane preparedness. You know, we get a hurricane, or we on hurricane alert every year. I don't want to say we get one because God forbid we don't need another one.
That's right.
But we're on hurricane alert every year. So we have to be able to try and mitigate certain risks or even have hurricane preparedness. Well, if something happened, we can move as quick as possible, right? So what it was is that the MOU was signed. They wrote a letter to the Cordaid Netherlands, which was a foundation in Holland, to build a crisis container. It was a crisis container project. This crisis container would pose as somewhat a shelter because, of course, as those who know, we don't have a shelter up here as yet in Salty Ward. It's something that the government is saying that they, you know, that we're looking into it. It's something that has to happen still. I know they had plans to build a multifunctional shelter and a community center in one, / community center. So in the interim, what they wanted to do was build this crisis container so that, okay, it would be solar powered, it would have a commercial kitchen, it would have wheelchair accessibility, it would have a small medical room for little minor injuries. So that was the purpose, and then of course to have our meetings. That was the purpose with the agreement with the Cordaid Foundation. Okay, that didn't happen. The container was placed there, but it was thwarted, it was stopped because government said, okay, listen, hold on, we're going to build the shelter, so it don't make sense put something there temporarily when we're going to build this structure, right? So what happened was, of course, in the last few years, government changed. And what happened was, before it was, when it was changed, the AUC now stepped in, because so it was stopped. So then the AUC stepped in, they said, okay, We ain't gonna do the crisis center, but let's do a playground. Let's have something, some kind of beautification for the area. Because, like I said, with the MOU, we signed with NBC to take care of not only the outdoor court, but if you notice, around the court has, they have the garbage bin there. Those who are familiar with the South Ward area, there's a garbage bin there. There's a tata listen, guys. You know, let's beautify the place a little bit, have a little beautification practicing on. And of course, that got stopped because of Hurricane Irma. That was in 2017, right? Of course, we know Hurricane Irma did devastating, it did colossal damage to not only the island of St. Martin, but the region as well. But we talk blues, we talk about blues.
David, what I wanted to know, David, as well, because okay, you touched on your house temporary in the NPC, meaning that I would guess that the management of NPC
allow
you all to have some space there to use for your meetings.
Correct.
I'm curious, was the NPC never used as a facility for
a shelter?
As a shelter for
absolutely. The NPC is indeed, in fact, then the NPC got. So the MPC school, like many other schools, got took blows too. They saw blows too. Okay, so like I said, the project with the AUC never materialized because of the hurricane. Okay, so now the MPC now took it blows. Then here comes the SMDF Foundation, along with the Red Cross. They say, listen, guys, we let's try and get the container going. So that at least we have somewhere to go in case we have another hurricane, we have something. And it was not just one container, it was supposed to be three 20-foot containers, right? So we have a somewhat of a shelter in the interim because NPC was broken down. Government, and I'm not, it's not I'm throwing shots at government. I understand that we did have various governments over 10 years. So it wasn't like one government that said no, you know? But government would attempt, because I must also say I am... Before I'm a community leader and president of the collective, I am a civil servant. So I work for the organization. So I'm not going to sit here and bash our organization right. I'm working for. It's nothing right. like that. But I'm just telling you facts. This is facts. This is something that government told them. Like, hey, listen, guys, let's hold on a bit, because what we're going to do, we working on this shelter, we want to give you guys a proper shelter. Okay? Years passed, and I guess it was, you know, pending. And not never materialize. Okay, so this is where we are right now. You know,
but I want to just back up a bit, David, because with your organization and stuff like that, I'm trying to get out of you if you are expanded into the whole South Ward area and the other districts that you will, in terms of upkeep of the infrastructure, correct. Sidewalks, street correct. Lights. Are you informing government? You know, when there's something that is not operating adequately,
absolutely.
You know, and the people in the community can come to your collectivity right. and inform you that listen, a light on this street is not functioning, or the sidewalk, or there's a hole in the road and stuff like that. But anything that has to do with these communities that you are able to then get back to the government or on your own, do whatever improvement is necessary. To keep your community or your districts maintained.
Yes.
Is it such that you are expanded into all of these areas that I just mentioned?
Correct. Okay, so let me, like I said, the initial concept for the organization was to be an association with these different chapters. So at the time, it was Ebenezer, it was Dutquart, it was South Ward. So what they wanted to do was, encourage more participation within different communities and have representatives from each community be part of the collective. However, the collective functions solely for South Ward. So the district of South Ward, that's what the collective function is. So we're not a collective for Dutch Quarter. It's just to have representatives from there to voice their opinion and of course collaborate. So whatever, because of course every district has its own challenges, but the main objective is just upkeep. So we can always share bunks of ideas off each other. So the collective currently functions solely for South Ward. We are trying to have, we do have communication with Raymond Hill, of course. We have communication with St. Peter's, but they have not established a council as yet. So that's still in the process. So we do have community leaders that we communicate with in case of any situation. But to answer your question with government, what we do is whenever there's an issue where it's beyond where it needs government assistance, we would then write government and say, hey guys, listen, we need this wreckage move, we need lighting in this area, we need Miss Juliana tree trim because, you know, she can't get to her driveway. We need Miss Bernice, Miss Bernice tree trim because it's a hazard, it's growing on a lamppost. Of course we'd have to involve GB and, you know, those type of situations. So government is definitely informed of the concerns that we have. What we stress and we want to really, really, really make a strong point on is that the collaboration that when government execute these initiatives. So when we go and tell them and say, hey, listen, we need lighting or we need a tree trim, that government also includes the community collective. So, well, we are a community collective, but also include the foundations as well, right? So in the councils in other districts, but we are collective. We need that collaboration. We need participation with government to reach out to say, hey guys, where exactly Ms. Juliana Tree is? What else is the issues that we have? And this is what we stress on. This is a very important point that we stress on severely, because going now I have to jump into, just to give a little thing, I have to jump into what happened yesterday to prevent situations like what happened yesterday. Yesterday, we had a situation with our reward tree. The tree we light up every year, giving. We haven't light up the tree in a couple of years. Pandemic was one of the situations why we didn't do it. The other situation was during December is the ending of the tenure of the board. Okay, so there was a transition of the board, and during that time we were busy with the transition, so we were not able to have the normal lighting of the reward tree. Okay, so those were 2 years, but every year before that, since the council been established, we've been lighting up that tree. So yesterday,
that tree meaning
the reward tree.
Tree. What tree?
The reward tree is a tamarind tree, that been there awesome. For a hunt.
Okay, so you're getting to that tree.
Yes,
that you're talking about.
That's the particular tree I'm talking about.
That is the reward tree.
That is the reward. So let me give you a history on that. The reward tree been there since Moses built the ark. You understand what I'm saying? Wow. Oh, that's older than that time. The reward tree has survived and survived disasters. Okay, we had Lewis in 95. We had Lenny, I think it was in 1999, I believe, or something in the 90s.
That's right.
So 99. When Lenny come down here and flood all the place, mash up that tree there in Dutch Quarter, that big tamarind tree in Dutch Quarter, where they took three days to chop down. They had to use a detour through Miller Region. You remember them times? For days, they had to use that route because Miller Region was busy. They took time to... So that tree, our tree, right, survived all those things, including Irma. Okay? So that tree has history. That tree was basically the government at the time earmarked that area, that tree. That's why it was called the reward tree. They earmarked that area. That's a symbol, okay? That's a symbol of resilience. That's a symbol of power. That's a symbol of unity, because the tree is a unique tree. That tree is a tree what is two tamarind trees are growing to one. That's unity. That's unity. That ain't a tree what just jump up and come about someday there, you know. That's a tree that have various meaning, that is a symbolism of South Reward community. Okay? That's what that tree means to us.
So in saying that, David, because you said a whole lot there, is that also recognized officially by government?
Government or not?
All that you said.
Not this particular government, but it is on record that it's earmarked as a reward tree. That's what it is.
You say on record.
Absolutely, absolutely, absolutely.
Established by a ministry. Or
absolutely, absolutely.
What ministry?
Okay, so at the time it was a William Maarten government. William Maarten was in charge. Of course, Mr. Maarten is from the South Ward area, and he earmarked it as the symbol tree, the area of South Ward. Okay, so like I said, we besides the couple years that I explained that why we couldn't do it, but it was okay, the tree that we light up. Some call it the Christmas tree. We come around there, we give the kids gifts, we have our little you know, we do our jubilee, we come, we give we have refreshments, everybody come there, and we have a day that we light up the tree, and then everybody could pass and they take the pictures with the tree and so forth. Okay? Now going back to yesterday. Of course there there are district cleaning companies that clean in the area. Of course, garbage disposals and stuff like that from certain contractors that facilitate these initiatives. So yesterday now I come in home and I noticed something strange one time, because just to explain to people who are not from South Jawa, the tree is a full tree, tamarind tree. Like I say, over 100 something years. The tree been there since I was going to Sister Magda as a little boy. Okay? And many other residents could attest to that too. We know that tree from our great-grandparents' days. Okay? The tree is a full tree. I noticed the tree but something off with that tree, man. I see the tree, and the tree full, a little full on one side, and then butchered, slaughtered on the next side. See that, man? I seen things. Come home. Soon as I reach home, my father now, y'all, you know how Duki is. Sure. He said, listen, you check your chat? I said, no, I was busy, at the job today, but when I reach home, I hear him, I said, ping, 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 ping. He said, your chat light up, your chat light, no, check your chat. I look at the chat, I see a picture of the tree from a resident that took a picture, the tree butchered, chop off. I said, nah, man. Who do this? The residents, listen, one thing with South Jawa, the residents, they don't play now. They keep fire under our foot now. They hold you accountable. Where the leaders? Where the council? What's this? Where's government? What government thing? Who's this? Who's the culprits for this? This and that and the third. Okay, boom. So now I get on the chat. I say, listen, I would look into this. I must say, because I can't say the bad without the good. I must say, I have a very good working relationship with the Minister of Rami. Okay, currently, I text him. The minister himself was in shock. I said, but minister, listen, we young, we millennials, I go talk to him. You understand? I know it's a respect. I know it's not like a disrespecting him, but we understand when I talk a certain way, he know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
And good night to his mother as well, Miss Henrietta. That's a sweet lady. The lady I was showing respect. Same for the minister to my father. Mr. Richardson, the basketball legend, you know what I mean? So it's a respect. I'm not bashing. It's not. It's nothing. So I know we in what we call an election year, and a year before election is nothing to do so.
Correct.
But I'm peevish. I feel peeved. I'm really upset.
I like what
you understand? Said. I feel peevish. I feel unsettled.
You feel
I feel flattered. I don't feel comfortable.
I don't know if you know Silverine Weaver.
That's my sister.
She said, I sit under that tree so many times.
You understand?
Walking from school to home.
You understand what I'm saying? Wow. That tree was a place where back in the day they used to butcher. That tree was a place they had a little bar, a little social setting. That tree meant something to South Jawa. So I get her jump on the phone, minister, but what was I said, but papa, what's this? I said, but what kind of bum job? This is amateur night at the Apollo. What kind of bum job is this? Now New Yorkers will say amateur night at the Apollo is like, this is an amateur job. What's this? Yeah. He said, bye David, this is beyond bum job. I must commend the minister.
That's what the minister said.
That's what the minister said. Wow. So he said, listen, let me.
He was told about it for the first time about it.
As a minister, when you're executing these district contracts, what you do, you give your tour, you give your updraft, your assignment, and you do what you have to do. So
and you expect it's carried out.
You expect it's carried out. Number one, the other thing said, but he said, but the tree ain't even on the road.
Exactly.
The tree ain't even on the road. Anyway, he said, David, I'll get back to you. Boom. So now I'm home. I take off my clothes, whatever, get ready to jump in the shower. I hear the chat lighten up. I look at the chat. I know the situation. I have to check the phone. Look at the chat. The chat, somebody say, no. Look at the chat. And I get a call. One of the residents say, hey, the culprit's there. You know, some man people say, hey, the culprit's there. I say, what? By throwing a pants half shot, halfway on, jump in my car, I flying down the road like a madman.
Yeah.
Flying down the road, good thing the road ain't busy. Flying down the road, I pull up on the side, When I reach there, I see two representatives from the company that did it. And I know the company. And you know it's unfortunate because I'm going to get to a point, right? I'm going to get to a point about that company. Fly down the road, and I see a representative from you, Mr. Scamine?
John Scamine.
From Behel Deans, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Scamine there, the two representatives there, and no one of the boys and go, the representative there. I jump out the Jeep, my train on my shirt. They must have said, but they're looking at me, but who this madman is? Because like I say, my people, let me search you, our people, not even my people, search you what, they hold us accountable, you know. They hold us accountable, so they keep me fire under we foot. They don't play, okay? So now I come out there, they must say, who this madman? And I start, but what kind of thing is this? And I talk to the panel, I ain't gonna call it him, because this ain't the blame game. I said, but bro, it's all you want to do that. He said, my God, everybody. Now I know, and I'm going to get to the company. I know the company that execute this thing. I ain't going to call the name, but the owner of the company, his name starts with a D. That's my boy, okay? I know if we had a meeting before, that you would have never get chopped down so. I know he gave an update to his workers. I know he ain't chopped down that tree. He gave an update to his workers. And I know he want to give the boys him a work, because listen, things tough. We want to give our local boys him a work. But that was utter laziness what happened there. They butchered that tree. The thick branch of the tree chop hack off. Hack off. If I go there and see that tree now, that tree look deplorable.
No, we saw
that's atrocious now.
Yeah, we saw the tree. We saw the tree we came earlier, Jeffrey and I. And it even, just like what you said, it even looked like they could be amputated.
Of course.
Of a human being.
Of
then
course.
They walk with one hand.
That if we, and this is my point. The minister, he did what he could. He sent them one time. So I talking to Scamine and I expressing my concerns. And he like, you know, he calmly thing and whatever. Okay. And you know, and they say, he said, boy, you know, we have to make a report and we're going to report it to the minister and this and that.
Yes.
But the owner of the company, I know him. His name starts with a D. I know him. I know if we had a meeting, he would have said, boy, bro, don't worry, I got you. I know him. He ain't a bad fellow. And like he purposely do it. So my thing is, so I ain't gonna come.
But then who gave them the assignment to get it done?
So I guess that's the assignment was made on Vromi in hurricane preparedness. I don't know if the minister tell him to do that. I know he gave the abdrak, trim the tree, I don't know who amateur went and do that. Because there's other things, trim and clean up on the side. Listen, I work government. The tour specifies what exactly need to be cleaned. Up in South Jawad is the trenches, is the side of the roads, trimming the trees that's hanging over the thing. Even the representative tell me, he said, boy, we have a tree there that blocking one of the roads, the tick signs. Mm-hmm. We're afraid to cut it because one of the neighbors kind of get on with us. So it goes back to my point to say that's why community council participation with government is so imperative. It's important for us to be a part of, hey guys, this is what we're going to execute. Was earmarked? Can you talk to the residents? Listen, tell the resident of XYZ, LB Scott Road, Miss Bonnie's, the tree hanging over, we're gonna clip it. Let them know. That's why the participation with the council is so important. I must commend, just after, I'm gonna digress for a second. I must commend Chantal Groenevelt from the Community Development Family and Humanitarian Health, Women's Help Desk. Chantal is creating, because what she's doing is right now she has this thing with this initiative, community risk mapping. Community risk mapping is in the same breath with hurricane preparedness. So what we do, I participated in that. What we do, we go around, check the capacity of the area. So the capacity would mean places that are shelters, places that we can use as distribution centers in case of a disaster and after. Though that information, and they specify certain hazards, fires, hurricane, God forbid tsunamis, etc. So that information would be who are supposed to be involved, community councils, third party, organization, government, and we specify certain information, then we will give that to government, so then there would be a quick response. When they have a disaster, boom, we done deal. Community councils, they created a program to train the CERTs. sorts of people, community experts in the community, who community leaders, first responders. We ain't always got to wait on ambulance. We ain't always got to wait on the nurse. We have first responders, community leaders in the community who are there, who are already situated here, who could say, you know what, bye? Boom, let's go out. Boom, we're going to attack it because we already have this information. We do the training. We're trained. We understand what's going on. I will regress. No, that's what the... So Chantal now, so going back, Chantal now is facilitating that so that that information could be given to government so that the government would then know, okay, this is, okay, South Ward Community Collective, this is what we know about IU, this is what we know where the shelters is, make sure I have our thing up to that, up to par, whatever cleaning, whatever need to be done, because something hazard, if you have a fire, South Ward don't have, I did community risk mapping in Dutch Quarter. Some houses built so compact, and Ms. Perla Rumley explained us why that was done. Some houses are so compact. But we had the situation with the fire. They had a fire not too long ago. One house catch a fire, every house catch a blaze.
The water?
Of course. All houses, and they saw the roads are so thick, the fire truck couldn't even go there. So what they had to do was run a hose from the well, go up the road, and then buckets. And we throwing buckets of water. Wow. And people had to, good thing they had people who were engaged in the community, and they were doing that. So that's the whole thing about community and community councils and government participation. That's what they're there for. I regress. I'm going back. So now the minister had a representative talk to them, and he's like, but you know, what's this? You understand? So now we have a treaty. Who responsible now for? Because we had a thing into it. Who responsible now for our Christmas tree and to say, well, hey, you know. The children them expecting a little thing because they're so excited now this year for the who won't contribute, who won't be responsible for this thing for us not having a thing, or if we even gonna have one, how are we gonna have it, what are we gonna do, hang people from the tree with lights, stand up with lights and lean up on the tree and thing with lights, come on, you know the tree look is atrocious, it hurt me. It hurt me, brother, because that's a tree I know for years. This tree is a symbol of South Ward. It hurt me. So what are we going to do now? How are we going to handle this now?
Where is the tree located?
The tree is located as you're coming up on LB Scott Road, which is the main road. You pass the MPC school. There's an outdoor basketball court.
On the right-hand side.
On the right-hand side. There was a big tamarind tree just before. And I'm going to get in that area too. Because now, I don't know... is a dumping, it become a dumping site for sand and all kind of thing. The garbage moved down there, the garbage was a little higher by the school, but now, okay, it's a little by the school, but now the garbage bin, the main garbage bin, is there by the residents. The residents now have a problem with rats. Then you have people on a hit and miss kind of situation from the castle. When they throw in the garbage into the bin, if it's the latter, a hit and miss kind of style. So if it's the latter, they ain't even coming out to pick up the garbage. So now the dogs, stray dogs, the thing. Listen, we facilitated our initiative with Epic Foundation. Council members, residents, other NGOs came out early on a Saturday morning, bright and early, 6, 7 o'clock in the morning, come to clean up that area. Now you should see it. We try to maintain it, but we also said, hey guys, government, can you include that in your term of reference so that that area could be cleaned and Tim, because we just use this area. You understand? Can it be cleaned and maintained and kept clean? We can only do so much. Now, this is not the blame game. I'm talking about conversations and things, letters written, registered letters written to the organization. Hey guys, can you just keep it clean? Residents are responsible too. I hold my residents responsible, our residents accountable too. We have to maintain the beauty, you know, to make sure if we got no beautification, at least make it look nice. It don't have to be an eyesore. We have a dumping site on one side. We have a garbage that, you know, just full of garbage around. And now we got a chop up tree in our school district.
I have a question. Pertaining to that same property. Who owns that property?
Is according to Mr.
sitting there?
Okay, according to Mr. Scamine, he said it was it's privately owned. But like I said, we have an MOU with the school. We wrote government, okay, even if it's privately owned, the owner's not doing nothing with it. So it's up to the residents and government to make sure it looks nice. But that the dumping site now, because the dumping site is a little higher up, as soon as across the entrance from Waymond Hill. So when you're going up Valley Estate up there, it's a whole pile of debris and dirt, and it looks horrible.
Yeah, it is terrible. It's terrible.
It's horrible.
Yes.
So even if, okay, why the person who owned the land ain't reach out and say, because now if government will tell him, but that my land, you can't tell me what to do. But then even to the person says, shit, boy, but that's shameful, man. That's an eyesore. That's shameful.
You see, again, there's where a lot of regulations come in.
The red tape and I understand that.
Like I said,
in the meantime, we gotta accept it.
It's a lot of regulations. I see here no coordinations. I see
no communication. Communication is key now.
And all of that kind of thing, you know.
Communication is so key.
Because the entities, because another thing, because I didn't get clear from you, if the government recognizes the collective. The collective.
So this is what I'm saying.
Is the collective recognized by government, specifically the Vrami ministry? Are they recognized?
So I would say this. I would reiterate this. I have a good working relationship with it. I don't know. Maybe it was a lack of communication that butchering happened yesterday. But I implore the government to just, the organization to just, before you do anything, just reach out. You know, there was community councils held about, we had town hall meetings. I actually, the minister stressed to me, say, David, I want to be there. I have other obligations, but I want to be there. So I had to kind of reschedule the town hall meeting, just to, and he showed up. And the residents was like, what? But you know how long we're trying to get a minister to come to one of our town hall meetings?